Thank you very much, Principal, for that welcome. I want to thank Dr. Lipman for his generosity in making it possible for me to be here. Of course, I want to thank you all for coming out to listen, or there would be much more point for me being here to give this talk. I was asked to speak, or I was speaking on ethical challenges of the 21st century, which I think a school is educating the leaders of the next generation should have a strong sense of awareness of the challenges we face and the world in which it's preparing those students to lead. So I want to give you some reflections on this very broad topic and say a little bit about some issues. But I won't go on too long because I want to leave some time for questions and discussion, because I think, given the breadth of what I'm saying, I hope you'll have comments to make on it. So, what are the challenges that we face as we get into the second decade of this century? They're somewhat different, I think, from the challenges that people of my generation thought about when we were maturing. We were maturing in a world in which, firstly, the shadow of two great world wars was still very close, and the prospect of a third and even more terrible world war seemed even closer. I was a teenager at the time of the Cuban Missile Crisis, for example, when the world seemed to come close to a nuclear Armageddon. And that was definitely one of the great fears, and I suppose if you'd asked me and my peers at that time, or when we were university students, what we were most worried about, nuclear war, the need for nuclear disarmament, was certainly central in our minds. That's receded somewhat, fortunately. Firstly, of course, there has been no nuclear war. There have been no nuclear weapons used since the two bombs dropped on Hiroshima. And more to the point, there has been no major war at all, no war between two major powers during that period. It's not that there haven't been wars. We all know that there have been wars, and there are wars continuing even now, including one in which Australian troops are involved. Nevertheless, the period since 1945, we can now look back on with more distance, has been a remarkably peaceful one. The number of people killed in war is relatively small. The wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, although they're focused on paying a lot of our attention, have really killed a very small number of people, even including the civilian toll. The war in Vietnam certainly killed significantly more. And there have been other wars that don't get so much attention in our news, in the Congo, for example, because essentially neither Australians nor Americans nor too many people of European descent generally are being killed there. So I don't want to give a facilely optimistic impression, but nevertheless, there has been much more peace than people in 1945 had much reason to believe was likely to happen over the next 65 years. And the chances of anyone meeting a violent death have dropped significantly, not only in war, but in other ways as well. So again, the media play up things like the terrorist attacks of September 11, 2001, and the media often give an impression of crime as being on the rise. Those sorts of things sell papers and get people watching. But the statistics show clearly otherwise. The chances of someone alive now meeting a violent death at the hands of their fellow humans is significantly lower than it has been at any previous time that we can record, we can get statistics on, in human history. And lower still, as far as we can best tell by looking at skulls and bones of people from prehistoric periods, lower still than human prehistory, where the rate of violent death seems to have been significantly greater than it was once states were formed. If you want to look at that in more detail, if you want to say, can that really be right, I recommend you look at Steven Pinker's most recent book, The Better Angels of Our Nature. It's a large tome, 700 or 800 pages, but it goes through the evidence, I think, fairly carefully. It makes a very convincing case that this is so. So although I wouldn't say, of course, it would be very foolish to say, and Pinker doesn't say, that we don't have to worry about war, or we don't have to worry about a world war or a nuclear war, we still should be concerned about those things, they don't seem to me to be the central ethical challenges that we should be focusing on. What should we be focusing on then? Well, I suppose what has replaced war as a central ethical challenge of the 21st century, I believe, is climate change. Now, I know there are some people who say, well, do we really know for sure that human activity is changing the climate of the planet? And to that I would have to say, if you mean by for sure, if you mean with 100% certainty, with the same certainty that if I pick up this jug and pour the water out, the water will fall on the floor rather than rise from the ceiling, then the answer, of course, is no. We don't know that with the same certainty. But I think we do know that the best of our scientific predictions, there's an overwhelming consensus, maybe one or two prominent dissenters, but there's an overwhelming consensus that human activity is causing climate change. And that's enough. That's enough, I think. We can't take the risk. Even if we couldn't be more than 50% sure, when you look at the consequences, I think we can't take the risk of saying, maybe this is not happening. Maybe the overwhelming consensus of science is wrong. I think we have to act on the basis of probabilities in life, and this seems to be a probability that, if they're right, it's so important, we can't just rest on wishful thinking. Now, why is this specifically an ethical challenge? It's an ethical challenge because at least the worst consequences of climate change are not going to come to us. Well, certainly not going to come to me. I'm 65, maybe I'll be around for another 20 years, all being well. But the worst consequences of climate change are further in the future. So some of you who are boys at school, perhaps, certainly you could see a lot more consequences of climate change in your lifetime. But the very worst consequences are likely to come even later, centuries hence. We're changing the atmosphere for hundreds and thousands of years, not just for the next few decades. And secondly, the worst consequences are also going to come not to us in the sense of Australians, but to people elsewhere in the world. You might say, is that right? Isn't it true that Australia is particularly vulnerable to climate change? Didn't we see that in the drought that we had in the previous decade that ended a year or two ago? Didn't we see how vulnerable we are to changing patterns? And if it's true that the intensification of the El Niño, La Niña effect is due to climate change, then we're going to have even more severe droughts in the future. And yes, that may well be true, but nevertheless, we are a fortunate country that even if we have these severe droughts, we are not going to starve as a result of them. We have things that the world needs that we can dig up and sell. They'll last for quite a while. We have skills, we have an educated workforce. We're not really going to starve. But if you get similar droughts happening in parts of sub-Saharan Africa or parts of India, where you have hundreds of millions of people who are dependent on agriculture, dependent on that for what they eat, and don't really have anywhere else to go if the rains fail. Or if you have tens of millions of people inhabiting fertile, low-lying delta regions in Bangladesh, for example, then their lives and their survival is put at stake by changes in climate which could vary the rainfall patterns which they rely on to grow their crops, and which could cause sea levels to rise so that the land that they're farming becomes inundated. And that's why it's quintessentially a moral problem. We are the ones that have to take action now. It's us, the developed nations, overwhelmingly, who are responsible for the problem, both responsible historically in terms of the emissions that we've emitted over the past century or two, and it's also, even today, we're the ones that are putting out vastly more emissions on a per capita basis than the developing nations that are most affected by it. Here's one little quick snippet to think of the difference in emissions. A German advisory body to the government produced a plan for sharing emissions equally up to 2050 in a way that would prevent the Earth's temperature rising more than 2 degrees Celsius, which they see as a kind of a safety barrier. They think if we can prevent the Earth's temperature rising more than 2 degrees Celsius, then the worst results of climate change will not happen. So I see that as an enormous moral challenge. But it's a really difficult moral challenge because it's a moral challenge that doesn't trigger any of the innate moral sense that we have. So I want to pull back from the present century for a moment and just talk a little bit about the basic evolution of morality to help you see why I see this as a serious problem and why this issue of climate change is so difficult for us to really feel as the serious moral challenge that it is. For most of our evolutionary history as human beings, and even our non-human ancestors, our primate ancestors, ancestors that we share with other apes, even going back that far, we have lived as social mammals in relatively small groups. Anthropologists think that the typical size for a human society is about 150 individuals. And within that group, we developed a moral sense. We developed a sense of right and wrong with things we do to others. And that includes a certain amount of sympathy with others, when we see others hurt. Of course, we can cut this off and we tune some people out. We're good at doing that sometimes. But we do have empathy and compassion for others. But because of our evolution in those small groups, we have that really at a face-to-face way. We know that we knew all of those 150 people that were part of our group, and we see them in front of us. And there's a steep drop-off in the empathy and compassion we have when we get beyond that small face-to-face society. And we still have a lot of those innate responses that evolve in order to make us live better within those small groups, and particularly to help our kin and to help those with whom we were in cooperative relationships, whose support we needed and could benefit from. All of that we have and we still feel very strongly. But then we develop much larger societies. We develop societies in which we move constantly among strangers. And finally, in really perhaps only in this century or the past century, we develop a global community of billions. And we do things that have consequences for others in that global community. So we are not really evolved to handle this as moral issues. We're not really evolved to relate, or we relate much better to people when we have direct, face-to-face kind of reactions. And we also relate much better to seeing moral issues where we have hands-on contact rather than action at a distance. Let me give you a couple of examples of that. As far as the difference between the hands-on contact and the action at a distance, there's an example that philosophers like to talk about, and we've been talking about quite a bit in the past decades, known as the trolley problem. And it's a little puzzle that that goes like this. You can ask people these questions, two different situations. So, trolley, by the way, here is an American term. We can use it as a train, generally. So this story goes, you're walking up a railway track when you see a runaway train coming down the hill of this track, has no driver in it. And you follow the line of where the track's going, and you see it's going into a tunnel where there's a gang of workmen working in the tunnel, five men working in the tunnel. It seems that the train is going to run into the tunnel and probably kill those five people who won't have warning to get out of the way. There's only one thing you can do. There happens to be a branch line. You can pull a switch, the train will go down the branch line. There's just one workman on the branch line who will probably be killed if you pull the switch. But there will be only one rather than five. So most people in that situation, I think roughly 80%, if you ask, would it be right for you to pull the switch? Most people will say, yes, it would be right. Then you vary the example a little bit. So you still have the runaway train, you still have the five people in the tunnel, but there's no branch line. Instead, there's a footbridge, and you're standing on the footbridge in front of, over the line, before the train comes to pass under the footbridge. You think about the possibility of throwing yourself in front of the train to stop it, but you're rather lightly built, and you realise it wouldn't help. The train would just pass through you, and you'd be killed, but five people would still be killed. Then you spot a heavy stranger carrying a large backpack, leaning over, it's a train buffer perhaps, leaning over to look at this train. And you realise you could give him a little push. And he would be heavy enough to stop the train, we assume. You might say, how do you know that? You just have to allow philosophers to know this. Almost everyone says no. And philosophers have cracked their brains to try and explain the difference. Well, in both cases, you're killing one to save five, aren't you? If you can kill one to save five by pulling a switch, why can't you do it by pushing the stranger? And philosophers have come up with various explanations, which have then been debunked by other philosophers, not very effectively explained. I think what's going on, this is not my idea really, it comes from a guy called Josh Green, really. What's going on is that we've evolved to have this innate horror at pushing someone to their death, because that was something we could always do for millions of years. And we have an inhibition, most of us, fortunately, have an inhibition against doing that to people. But we never evolved with railway trains or switches, so we don't have the same evolved inhibition to throwing a switch. So global warming is more like throwing a switch. What could be wrong with taking your car for a drive? What could be wrong with running the air conditioning? What could be wrong with jetting around the world? How do those things harm anyone? In our revolutionary history, they never did. But now they do. And that's what makes a difference. That's one example. Let me give you another example which shows better the face-to-face issue. And it connects to one of the other great moral challenges that we face in this century. And that's the issue of global poverty. And I would argue that here too, we have moral challenges that we're not really facing up to. We're one of the wealthiest nations on earth. We're very fortunate to be here. Some of us, of course, have worked very hard to have comfortable lives. Others have been more fortunate. But basically, all of us have been fortunate to be in Australia, in a country that enables us to have comfortable lives. Warren Buffett, one of the richest men in the world, when somebody suggested to him that he deserved his fortune, he worked hard for it, he said, "If I'd been born in a village in a mountain in Peru, my skill at picking stocks would have done me no good at all. I would probably have been just as poor as the next villager." So in that sense, he acknowledged that he was lucky. And I think we are. Yet we know that there are a billion people living in poverty in the world, in extreme poverty, and we really do very little to help them. We currently, as a government, give about 32, or maybe it's now 35, cents in every $100 we earn in foreign aid. It's 0.335 of our gross national product. It's really a minuscule amount. And on top of that, we give a small amount in non-government aid through organisations like Oxfam and Save the Children and so on. But it wouldn't take it up to even 50 cents in every $100 we earn. So I think it's really, again, not rising to the challenge of helping those who are in great need and who are less fortunate than us, and whose children are far more likely to die before they reach their fifth birthday because of the extreme poverty they live in. Something like 8.8 million children die every year, UNICEF tells us, because of avoidable poverty-related diseases. That's about 22,000 every day. Football stadium full of children dying every day from avoidable poverty-related diseases. Now, let me go back to the difference between the face-to-face society and the society of women, because some psychologists ran an experiment directly intended to test that. They got some students in the campus saying, "We'll pay you $15 for a half-hour psychology experiment." Students come in, they're given a questionnaire to fill out, it takes them about half an hour, they assume that that's the experiment. When they leave, they hand in the questionnaire, they pay the $15 in small notes, and then they're told about a charity that the psychology department chooses each month to support and asks if they would like to donate to that charity. And randomly, half of them receive a little leaflet which has a picture of a young African girl. It says, "This is Rokia, she's 7 years old, she lives in Malawi, she goes to bed hungry most nights, your donation can help her." And the other half were given a leaflet with no photo of a child, but were told, "In Malawi, thousands of children go to bed every night hungry. Your donation can help them." Well, as you would expect, if the story that I was telling about our moral intuitions, our emotional responses, is right, those who received the picture of Rokia gave substantially more than those who received the statistical information. Because we're geared to respond to faces and names and identifying details. When you think about it, there's something a bit crazy for that. Because you have to ask yourself, did those students, remember they're university students, they shouldn't be totally stupid, did they really think that all the money the psychology department was collecting was going to go to this one girl? So she was rapidly going to become the richest person in her village? Not likely when you think about it. So they must have realised that this was somehow just something to attract their attention, yet nevertheless it worked. And I think that's a big problem that we have to face in terms of this, both of these challenges, global warming and global poverty. We have to somehow try to get people to respond to individuals and realise that we're affecting individuals. and realise that actions which are not hands-on violence are really harming. Can we do that? I think it's going to be difficult to do that. We have some technologies that may help us. I think the rise of the internet is an amazing phenomenon, and it does hold out hopes of change in a lot of different ways. We've seen with the Arab Spring how the internet helped people, even in quite repressive regimes, to organise, spread ideas, to get themselves together. That's a wonderful thing. It can also connect people to other people. I just noticed a little thing about this just in the last day or two, actually, that's quite curious. It's not possible to make a phone call from Israel to Iran. You try and dial a number in Iran when you're in Israel, the call just won't go through. You can post something on the internet from Israel, and it can be read by people in Iran. And so, someone recently posted something saying, "Iranians, we don't want to bomb you. We hate Iran." And thousands of other Israelis saw it, liked it, and spread the message. And then Iranians started seeing it. And they did the same in response. They said, "Israel, we don't want a nuclear bomb. We want peace." Now you might say this is naive, you know. Does this mean that Netanyahu is less likely to want a military strike against Iran? Does that mean that Ahmadinejad is less likely to build a nuclear bomb? Probably not. I don't know whether a certain number of people who joined this, it might make a difference. I don't know. But it does show the possibility of direct contact between people. And I hope that something like this can work with the issues that I've been talking about as well. I hope that people can actually see those living in extreme poverty as individuals, and that they can see the perils that they're placing them in by climate change, though that may take more time. Now, of course, we can't see people in extreme poverty if they're not connected to the internet. There's a problem there, and if you're living in extreme poverty, you probably don't have an internet-linked computer. In fact, you probably don't have electricity either. But it's not impossible that we can make these things happen. Mobile phones are already making a difference, even in quite remote rural villages in India and sub-Saharan Africa. They're enabling people to be in contact with each other. They're enabling small farmers to know what price they could get for their grain if they travel to market, which is a difficult thing for them to do, an expensive thing to do. And basically that means that the dealers who come to their village and lie to them about the price they could get in the village to try and get the grain cheaper are no longer able to deceive them. So mobile phones can make a difference, and maybe that kind of technology can be connected to internet connections that are fast enough for us to have a better understanding and a better contact with the rest of the world. So I do see some hope in that area. That's one technological difference. Obviously, we also have to hope that we can develop better technologies to reduce the amount of fossil fuel that we use, because that's another technological breakthrough that we need. Some people in the United States are pessimistic about the US ever really making the tough political decisions on climate change. And if the US isn't going to do it, you can be reasonably sure that other nations who haven't emitted anything like the amount of greenhouse emissions historically that the US has, nations like China and India, are probably also not going to control their emissions. Why should they? So maybe technology can help us find better ways of creating clean energy. That's a possibility. But there are other things that we can do as well, and I think we should be doing sooner. And I want to mention one of them because it links with another major ethical issue that I want to talk to you about. And that's the issue of our diet, what we eat, and of how that relates to the ethics of how we treat the non-human environment, non-human animals in particular. The connection with climate change is that we now know that meat is responsible for a large portion of our greenhouse gas emissions. The United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization issued a report called Livestock's Long Shadow, which calculated that the livestock industry produces more greenhouse gas emissions than all of transport, all of cars and trucks and buses and aeroplanes put together. The chair of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change actually made a plea for people to eat less meat because it's very carbon intensive. And I think, in fact, more recent work has suggested that even these estimates might be an underestimate. That, in fact, the weight given to methane, which is one of the major livestock emissions, is too small because it's calculated of the effect methane has over a century. And methane breaks down much more quickly than carbon dioxide. So when you compare the effect they have over a century, although methane is still more carbon, has more of an impact on climate change than carbon dioxide, it's about 25 times as much. But if you focus not on a century, but on a 20-year period, then the balance changes because the methane is still mostly there over 20 years. So over a 20-year period, methane is at least 72 times as intense in its impact on climate as carbon dioxide. And some people have said, or recent figures suggest, maybe 105 times as intense. So this throws the balance still further and suggests that for a 20-year period, for example, Australia's livestock produce more greenhouse gas emissions than all of our coal-fired power plants, which we've generally seen as a big problem we need to change. It is still a big problem. We need to change that. But we need to reduce the amount of livestock emissions as well. So I think that's an important reason why we need to change our diet in order to have an in order to reduce our contribution to climate change. But there are many other aspects of that as well that I do want to mention, since it's something that I've been involved in for about 40 years now, and that is that it can hold the hope of bringing a new and better ethical attitude to non-humans as well. I've been talking about expanding ethics beyond our immediate small community to humans in the world as a whole. But I think we need to expand ethics to non-humans as well, to all sentient beings, to all beings who can feel pain. I think are entitled to have their interests considered and not discounted simply because they are not members of our species. I use the term speciesism to refer to this attitude of saying, well, if a being is not a member of my species, I'm not really going to care that much about how much it suffers. And I think we need to move away from it. This is not to say, some people parody the animal rights movement by saying that, well, you know, are you going to say that it's wrong to kill a mosquito? Are you going to say that pigs and cows ought to have a right to vote? We're not talking about that, of course, at all. We're talking about sentient beings, and I'm doubtful whether mosquitoes are even sentient. But certainly we're talking about equal consideration for similar interests. So it's particularly the vertebrates, where we can be clear that they have a capacity to feel pain, that we ought to be concerned about. But anyway, any beings where we have reasonable grounds for believing that they are conscious beings, that they have experiences, states of mind. The next stage will be to expand ethics to non-human animals as well. We've made some progress in doing that. The kind of reaction that Animals Australia's video of the slaughterhouse in Indonesia got recently, and also the Australian slaughterhouse in Newcastle, is, I think, a sign that we have made some progress. I don't think 30 years ago that footage would have got anything like that reaction. But still, we have a long way to go, because we still have intensive factory farms which give miserable lives for animals simply in order to produce animal products a little more cheaply for us. So I think that's the further expansion of our moral horizons in addition to the challenges of climate change and global poverty. As I said, I want to leave you with plenty of time for questions, but I just want to say a couple of other things. Firstly, can we really solve these problems? Can we be morally good enough to make these changes? I've suggested some difficulties in human nature. Some philosophers and scientists have speculated that in order to get better at this, we may really need to enhance our nature. We may need to use, again, the science and technology we've developed to turn ourselves into better beings. Some people use the term transhumanism to say humanism is not enough. We're too forward. We need to take the next step and become transhumans. And other people have that instinctive yuck reaction to this idea of tinkering with human nature. I don't really have a firm view on this. It's possible. It's possible that we could use genetic selection to identify genes that relate to altruism or compassion and select for those that are more like this. But what if one country did that and another didn't? That, since evolution would still be proceeding, that obviously would not be a good thing. Other people have suggested biochemical means. There's been research that shows that certain aromas in the room can make people more generous, not quite as effectively as the picture of Rocky. Or getting people to use a nasal spray that contains oxytocin, a human substance that is released, for example, when women give birth to a child, their oxytocin levels go up. But that can make people more compassionate. So these are possibilities, but I think they're quite speculative. Others have suggested that an even more high-tech solution lies around the corner, and that is super-intelligent computers. Some people predicted that by 2070, computers will have developed that are smarter than us and that can build even smarter computers themselves, and we'll become obsolete. And maybe they'll be better, but maybe they'll be worse. That's the worry, I guess. They may take over the world, but they take over the world in a benign way. I find that, again, really too speculative to concern ourselves with, but they are things that have been talked about. What then can we do with the resources that we know that we have to try to make the world a better place? I think that this is possible, and I think we haven't really tried it enough. It's only relatively recently that we've got to the point that we don't really have to worry so much about our own security and that of our children. That we can live in a society where, although certainly the economy may go down, things may be tougher than they are now, we can have reasonable assurance that we are not going to suddenly find ourselves starving or unable to feed our children. And again, technology has helped to give us that assurance by making it so much easier for us to produce enough to meet our basic needs. So can we then refocus on these larger goals that I've been talking about and make them into our goals? I think that it may be possible. I'm not going to be more optimistic than that, but I do think that it may be possible. And one of the reasons that I think it may be possible is that when people try it, when people become bolder in leading a moral life, in leading a life that is concerned for a broader community, they typically find it a rewarding and satisfying experience. And many other people say this. Again, there's good evidence that shows that there's a correlation between how much people give to charity and how happy they are, how satisfied they are with their lives. Now, correlation doesn't show a causation. It may be that happy people are just more ready to give. But it's nice to know that they go together. It means that if you do give, the chances are that you're a happy person. And there is a little bit of other evidence for this. I was talking to Dr. Lipman before he came in about neuroscience. So there are studies that show that if you scan people's brains when they have to make a decision whether to give or not to a charity, those that do give show a strong response from the reward centers of the brain, the same parts of the brain that light up when we have delicious food or great sex or other things that give us joy and pleasure, also light up when we give. And this is not just because we want others to know that we're good people. It happens even if they give in a way that's completely anonymous, so that no one will know whether they've given or not. So it does seem that giving is an intrinsically rewarding experience. And I think that what we need is to get more people doing this, get a critical mass building up. And there are now some organisations that are doing this. You can look at them online, particularly relating to global poverty. There's one called Giving What We Can. And I also set up a website called The Life We Can Save, which is the title of the book that I've written, both of which are intended to get people to make pledges publicly to help the global poor in a significant way, so that others can see that they're doing it and join them and work towards it. And some of my most inspiring moments in the United States recently have been students who are dedicating themselves, dedicating their lives to doing this, to making, either to making aid more effective, to publicising the effective aid organisations, or to encouraging people to take the view not only that living an ethical life is rewarding, but that living an ethical life requires going beyond the traditional conception, which was basically a rule of thou shalt nots, and instead adding thou shalt share some of your good fortune with those who are far, far less fortunate in the world. I'll stop there. Thank you for listening. I'll be happy to take your questions.